Reading verses 1 through 18. If you don't have your Bible, there are those in the pew racks. I invite you to open it up to the Gospel of John, fourth book in the New Testament. I'll be reading from the New Revised Standard Version. Early, on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciples, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in. And he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned where? To their homes. That's weird. But Mary. Stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there. She did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." And Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned. And said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go, to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." I have seen the Lord. And she told them that he had said these things to her. Would you pray with me? Lord, I pray this morning that your Holy Spirit would overshadow me, that the words that I speak would not be my words, but yours. God, help me to just stay out of your way to let you speak. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. In a church in East Texas, it was Easter morning, and the choir had prepared, and they were ready to process in, and organ struck up from the grave he arose, and they were marching in, and the women were going first, and the men were following, and just as the last woman got there, she stepped on the grate in the middle of the aisle, and her heel in her shoe stuck in the grate. Well, she just slipped her foot out of that shoe and just kept right on walking. Well, the next man behind her thought, well, he'll just get her shoe for her, so he bends down, picks up the shoe, and the whole grate came with it. And so he just continues to process on down, holding the shoe and the grate. Well, the man coming behind him didn't see what happened. He fell. All the guys behind that, they all just walked around it and left him down there. And as the choir got up into the choir loft and the organ got silent, this man's voice came from below and said, "Look out, because I'm coming up." And this little girl in the house said, "Come on up, Jesus, we'll stay out of your way." I tell you, the early service today kind of felt like that. Because I told them, we have a saying in the South that when things keep going wrong, you're snake bit. Well, we were snake bit at the early service this morning, so I know how these people felt. Have you noticed how many important things in the Bible happened in the garden? Remember the first garden, the Garden of Eden, is where the humans were tempted by Satan, and they sinned. They could not resist that temptation. They sinned, and because they sinned, then mankind was eternally, at that point, separated from God. And there arose a way that God had for their sin to be covered, because the first thing he did was to kill an animal. Remember that? We talked about this not long ago. That he killed an animal. That was the first blood sacrifice. And remember that sin always requires a blood sacrifice. We should hold on to that, because that's really important about what we're going to talk about later on. And so he made a sacrifice and covered their sin by putting skins over their nakedness. And then the next time we see a garden, and Satan is there again, and this time it's Jesus he's tempting. This time he's whispering in Jesus' ear, you don't have to do this. You have all the power. You do not have to go to that cross and die. There is another way. But Jesus, say, but Jesus, said, nevertheless, not what? My will, but your will be done. Important thing that happened in the garden. And now we see another garden. And this time we see Mary. And Mary has prepared spices. She wants to anoint the body of her master that she's followed for all of these years. She prepared those spices. She and the women prepared those spices on the day of preparation. But on the Sabbath, they rested. Can you imagine what must have been going on in their hearts and their minds on that time in between? How many of you have ever had to wait for a funeral after a loved one has died, and then there's that space of time between when they die and the funeral? Those are hard days, aren't they? Can you imagine what they were feeling during this period of time? Questioning, asking, why? If we had all the hope. Just last week, we saw Jesus make the triumphal entry in. We saw him riding on a donkey, which is a sign of being a king. We heard people praising him and saying, hallelujah. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And now, he's dead. He's dead and he's in a tomb, and we're waiting so that we can go and anoint his body. And so she goes to the tomb that night, weeping. Remember they kept saying, woman, why are you weeping? And she sees the stone rolled away. But what was the first thing that entered her mind? Somebody took my Lord. Somebody took the man I came looking for. I came looking for my dead teacher. I came looking for my dead master. I came looking for the one that I saw die on the cross, laid in that tomb, and they've taken his body away. And of course, she did the first thing she could think of, to run back and tell the other disciples, and Peter and John. We know it was John. John always referred to himself as the one Jesus loves. He never called himself John. But they come to the tomb. John looks inside, but he doesn't go in. Peter does. Peter does, old brash Peter. He's always the first one. He goes in. And eventually John goes in. But then they do what? What did they do then? They went home. What were they thinking? Was there nothing that they wanted to investigate? I mean, it's really kind of odd, except if you look what it said. When the other one went in and said he looked and he did what? He believed. He remembered what Jesus had said and he believed. Maybe he just went back to wait for instructions. I don't know what was in his mind. But Mary, say, but Mary. She hung in there. She stayed there. Because you see, she was still focused on what she went there to do. Now you wonder, why didn't she recognize Jesus? Well, there's two really good reasons. Number one, she was looking the wrong way. Where did it say she was looking? She was looking into that empty tomb, wasn't she? It's almost as if he was going to materialize again. And suddenly he And so she had her back to Jesus. She was not focused in the right direction. And the other was her eyes were full of tears. Anybody ever been blinded by tears? Have you ever been crying so hard that you couldn't see? And so here she was, looking in the wrong way, crying for someone who wasn't there. She was looking, and I'm going to tell you, I didn't use bad grammar accidentally when I said, who are you looking for? Because who is very important for us. It's important for us to know who Mary was looking for. Mary was looking for a dead teacher. Mary was looking for a dead man. Amen? She was not looking for a living Lord. My question to us sometimes is, who are we looking for? I hear people say very often that Jesus, I can't really quite accept that he is the Son of God. I cannot quite accept that Jesus is God. I know he walked on this earth. I know he lived, but I think he was just a good teacher, or he was a good prophet. Well, let me tell you something. You can't have that. That can't possibly be. I love what C.S. Lewis said, and I'm paraphrasing what C.S. Lewis said. He said that either Jesus Christ was who he said he was, or he was insane, or a liar. And who he said he was that he was God. That's what he said. If you don't believe that, let's read the 14th chapter of John. It says, do not let your hearts be troubled. He's talking to his disciples. As he knows he's leaving, they know he's leaving, he's talking to them. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe, say believe.
Believe.
Believe in God. Believe, say believe.
Believe.
Also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will, say I will, come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I'm going. Thomas said, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way. Say that. I am the way. And the truth and the life. No one, say no one, comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. Let me say that again. He said, if you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father and we will be satisfied. He just still didn't get it, did he? Jesus said to him, have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. Can you make it any clearer than that? Say, whoever.
Whoever.
Whoever has seen me has seen who? The Father. Do you believe that? He said. Do you believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? I am. Do you remember when Moses was standing there looking at the burning bush, hearing the voice of God, and he said, when I go back to tell the Israelites that you sent me, who do I tell them? And who did God say? Tell them, I am, has sent me. And so when Jesus said, I am, he was identifying himself as God. So he can't just be a good teacher, amen? But here's the thing. We wonder sometimes who it is that we're looking for. Who is it that we're looking for when we come to church on Sunday morning? Are we looking for somebody that will just tell us a better way to live? Are we looking for someone who will just tell us that everything in our life is going to be great if we become a Christian, if we accept him? Are we looking for somebody in a three-piece suit who's going to stand up here and tell you that everything's always going to be okay? That you're never going to have any sorrows, that you're never going to have any troubles. That's not what Jesus said, is it? What did he say? He said, in this world you, what? Will have tribulation. He didn't say might, didn't say maybe. He said you will have tribulation, but be good, of good cheer. I love the buts in the Bible, don't you? But be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. And you see, that's what he did on that first Sunday. That's what he did on that resurrection day. He overcame the world. He overcame the sin. He was the last sacrifice. Remember when I said earlier that sin always requires a blood sacrifice? And up until that time, they had to make sacrifices for their sins over and over and over again. But you see, when Jesus told Mary, "Don't touch me," he had become the high priest. Because he had been the sacrifice, his blood was there, it was shed to cover our sins, but yet he had not yet taken it to the Holy of Holies. When the high priest was cleansed and ready to take the blood on Atonement Day into the Holy of Holies, nobody could touch him, nobody could defile him, because he had to go into the Holy of Holies and take the blood. Jesus Christ had to take the blood to the very Holy of Holies on that Sunday. And that's why he said to Mary, "Don't touch me." Here's the question. Who are you looking for? And do you believe? Jesus said, "Do you believe?" And he also told Mary, he said, "Go and do what?"
Tell.
Go and tell. Guess what? The very first evangelist was a woman. Go and tell my disciples. Go tell what you have seen. Is that not what a witness does? They tell what they have seen. They tell what they have experienced. I heard somebody talking about Disney earlier. You know, we can tell people what a wonderful time we had at Disney. Joe and I love the Rock and Roller Coaster. We like it so much that he bought one of those Steven Tyler wigs. And it glows. It glows. And I can come back and I can tell people how much fun that is because of why I experienced it. And you see, if we believe, if we truly believe that Jesus is the Lord, if we truly believe that he is raised from the dead, and we have experienced his transforming power in our lives, then we can go and tell. Amen?
Amen.
And that's what he said for us to do. Go tell. Go tell. If you believe, go and tell. If you believe, will you stand with me and let's say this together? It's on the screen or it's on in your bulletin. Christ is alive in the world.
I believe that.
Christ is alive in me.
I believe that.
Through my tears, I will see his face.
I believe that.
In my confusion, I will seek his guidance.
Hallelujah.
In my sin, I will repent and receive his forgiveness.
Hallelujah.
In my death, I will claim eternal life with him.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah indeed. Let's pray. Lord, I just thank you so much. Thank you for this day and for what it means. I thank you that when Jesus died on the cross and shed that blood covers our sin for now and forevermore. We never have to make another sacrifice because it's done once for all. And Father, I thank you that you have given us this reminder, this day to celebrate year after year, to be reminded of how important it is what you did for us. And help us, God, that when we come into your house, that we will come seeking a living Lord and not a dead teacher. Help us, Lord, to live into the salvation that he has given us. Help us to allow him to transform our lives from the inside out. Because all power is yours, Almighty Father. Amen. Join us in the last song.
This last song is called "You Believe." You may have heard it done by the Newsboys on the radio or something like that. But as we go, we want to have a response to what we just heard. We want to proclaim that Jesus is risen, but to apply that salvation and atonement that he has done for us to our lives, it requires faith. It requires personal commitment. So we invite you to sing with us. And if you've never done that, we encourage you, just check out his claim. Check out what he says about himself in the Word of God in the Bible. And see if you truly do believe. And this is our response. Those of us that believe this, we encourage you to check this out if you haven't.
of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen. Shake somebody's hand, give them a hug, and say, I believe. Do you?
I believe.